There is a world where anything is possible. Where love is the key ingredient. And dreams are made into a reality. Is there a deeper message than what's on the surface? Are these fables innocent stories? Or could they be dangerous allegories? Do these tales contradict the word of God? What exactly do these movies teach you about magic? And more importantly, which kingdom will you choose to belong to? It all started back in 1928 when Mickey Mouse made his debut in Steamboat Willie, resulting in the development of one of the world's most iconic businesses, the Walt Disney Studios. What used to take a team of people hand-drawing each and every frame has now evolved into teams of people constructing every fiber using high-powered computers. Even though the technology has drastically changed the way that cartoons are made, there are still some things that have remained the same. Cartoons don't abide by the same rules and laws that we humans do. They live in a world where virtually anything is possible. Physical laws such as gravity, time, and space don't apply in the cartoon world. Animals don't talk, and neither do lamps and clocks. Even moral laws seem to be bent or broken. Violence has always been a part of cartoon history. What is it about this form of storytelling that is taking the world by storm, with people from around the world flocking into theaters to see them?
Pixar Animation Studios, owned by parent company Disney, is set to release its third installment of the Toy Story animated franchise this weekend, and analysts expect the film's $9 billion worldwide franchise to receive an added $2.4 billion in retail sales as a result.
Opening with a staggering $109 million at the box office in only 3 days, are these films having an effect on our youth? Why do so many young girls want to be princesses, idolizing their every words? The girls and the boys acting out their favorite fantasies.
I can fly.
No, you can't.
You can.
Yes, I can.
You can.
You can. I can. I'm telling you I can fly along the swing.
My eyes closed.
Okay then, Mr. Lightbeard.
Science might have an answer for why we imitate what we see.
This is brand new science. This is just out of the lab. We may have some special circuitry in our brains that helps us whenever we look at each other.
Well, as it happens, scientists have an explanation for this strange ability to connect. It's new. And it began entirely by accident at a laboratory in the lovely old city of Parma, Italy, where a group of brain researchers was working with monkeys. And they were testing a neuron, that's a brain cell, that always fired, made this sound, whenever the monkey would grab for a peanut. So the lab had all these peanuts around, and whenever the monkey made its move, the neuron would fire. Scientists thought, now here's a neuron that is essential to motion. It's a motor neuron. Then one day, the monkey was just sitting around, not moving at all, just sitting, when a human scientist came into the lab, and when that scientist grasped the peanut, yeah, the monkey's cell fired. Now, the monkey hadn't moved. It was the human that had moved, suggesting that this neuron up here couldn't tell the difference between seeing something and doing something. Seeing and doing were the same.
Or more intriguingly, that for this neuron, watching somebody do something is just like doing it yourself. To demonstrate, he put me into this very powerful fMRI brain scanner that can peer into the brain while it's working. And he gave me some goggles so he could show me pictures when I was in there.
So you can see here the eyeball of Robert.
And once he had a good view into my brain...
Nice looking brain.
Thank you.
Robert, you're not supposed to talk when we scan you, all right?
Sorry.
Then he said, okay, I'm going to show you a bunch of faces. And for each face, I want you to imitate it. So I did that. Then he recorded my brain while I moved my facial muscles.
You're going to do right away another one.
Okay.
Then he said, okay, same faces, but this time, don't move a muscle. Just look. So I looked. When we checked the results...
Oh, there's my brain. I've never seen my brain before.
This is your mirror.
Iacoboni says that the part of my brain that's working when I make a face, the same part gets busy when I see the face.
So if you're watching a cartoon with an angry or violent scene, your mirror neurons are firing as if you were doing the very same angry or violent act. It makes sense why Christ made this statement in Matthew 15:21-22. Ye have heard it said of them of old time, Thou shalt not kill, and whoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say unto you, that whosoever is angry with his brother without a cause shall be in danger of the judgment. We know that the act of violating God's laws starts in the mind. Jesus illustrates it like this in Matthew 5:28. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Speaking about lust, what about the overly sensual characters that cartoons often portray? If we have these mirror neurons, could this be teaching our children to behave inappropriately? After all, we learn best from observing, right?
Pop booty! Yoo-hoo-hoo!
Monkey see, monkey do, I want to play, we all know you. Monkey see,
monkey see,
monkey do,
monkey do, I want to play with all of you.
And we develop our notions of reality from the cultural mechanisms around us. And one of the most important cultural institutions that we have today is indeed the media. What's amazing when you look at Disney and Disney movies over the years is how little the image of females has really changed. You still have the same highly sexualized female body with the big breasts, the tiny waists, the fluttering eyelashes, the coy expressions, the seductress. These images seem very similar over the years, and even when they're in animal form, you know, you've got this very seductive little female animal. Hello? This presents people with a kind of notion of what femininity is about. This is not a mirror on society. This is not reflecting who women really are or what females really are. It is basically constructing notions of what femininity is. And these are not notions that necessarily Disney invented, but what they do with these notions is they caricature them, they wrap them up in this magic kingdom wrapper, and they sell them to children. And that's really the power of Disney.
When they're young, they're trying to figure out, what does it mean to be a woman? What do I look like if I'm a girl? What should I look like? And they'll focus on the most salient, dramatic images they can see. They don't necessarily think about, well, that doesn't look like the women I know in real life. They don't make those kinds of comparisons, because that's kind of like making a movie, putting a whole story together, doing logical comparisons. They think about one slide at a time. This is how it looks here. Gee, that's interesting. Maybe I want to look like that.
Jasmine in the Aladdin film, in which there's a scene where she becomes a seductress to distract the person who's after Aladdin.
I never realized how incredibly handsome you are.
That's better. Now, Pussycat, tell me more about myself.
Your beard is so twisted.
This I find very dangerous, because you have, again, it gives young girls and the idea that that is the way that you get what you want. You use your body.
Even Toy Story 3 has subtle hints of sexual innuendos. So after meeting Barbie for only 5 minutes, Ken is ready to invite her to live in his home. This is a dangerous message that kids are being exposed to.
Hi, I'm Ken.
Barbie, have we ever met?
I would have remembered.
And in only 5 minutes...
Will I see you again?
Oh, I'll see you tonight.
In my dreams.
No.
Ken, let's get a move on.
Barbie, come with me. Live in my dream house. I know it's crazy. I know we just met. Ah, heck, you don't know me from G.I. Joe, but when I look at you, I feel like we were
made for each other. Yay!
Yes!
Ken?
Coming, lad.
That true love is based on an external beauty, which causes one to be impulsive. The Bible is very specific about God's plan for giving us sexuality within the marriage context. There is a big difference between love and lust. Solomon, the wisest man to ever live, warns us very clearly in Proverbs 6:24-26, "To keep thee from an evil woman, from the flattery of a tongue of a strange woman, lust not after her beauty in thine heart, neither let her take thee with her eyelids. For by means of a whorish woman, a man is brought to a piece of bread, and the adulteress will hunt for the precious life." The Ten Commandments, God's holy law, is being undermined in such subtle ways. God has repeatedly asked us to keep his precepts with all of our hearts. In Deuteronomy 6:17, it says, "Ye shall diligently keep the commandments of the Lord your God, and his testimonies, and his statutes, which he hath commanded thee." And in Ecclesiastes 12:13, it says, "Let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter. Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man." In fact, one of the underlying themes in most of Disney's movies is that we should follow our hearts, not the law. This is a very clear message in Disney's Mulan 2, a story about two types of Chinese marriages, an arranged marriage and a voluntary marriage. The movie opens giving honor to what they describe as the savior of China.
Oh, savior of China. You have ennobled the house of Fa. In gratitude, we honor you. All veneration to you, almighty...
Say my name.
Mushu.
That's what I'm talking about.
Savior is a little red dragon? The story is about this character, Mulan, who is set to marry this particular warrior. Their mission from the emperor is to escort all three of his daughters to be wed in arranged marriages.
But Shang, an arranged marriage?
I know, but not everyone can be as lucky as we are. In an ideal world, everyone would marry for love. But the world isn't perfect. I'm just glad my world is.
This red dragon, China's savior, is Mulan's guardian.
My world. Talk about selfish. You know, you don't hear me bragging about how it's my world, even though it pretty much is.
The dragon gives Mulan advice.
Am I a guardian or am I a guardian?
Oh, you're more than that, Mushu. You're my most trusted friend.
The dragon, which is more like the devil, is her most trusted friend? So as these two plan their own wedding, Mulan's little dragon wakes the dead to help with the planning.
All right. Wiki dead people, we got work to do, so let's move with purpose.
The dragon has rulership over them.
Now Mulan's getting married!
The dead are excited over this news because if Mulan gets married, the dragon loses his guardianship over the world.
Hey, this looks like a for real pink slip. You know, like a you're fired pink slip.
Oh, it is.
Say what?
The pink slip is for you.
It is written, once a woman marries, her husband's ancestors take over the duty of guardianship.
No. Your scroll must have a typo. That can't be.
Oh, but it is. You're out of a job.
Out of a pedestal.
And out of our hands.
I know another similar story, that when the bridegroom marries his bride, the dragon will be out of a job. You see, when Christ comes to take his bride, the church, home with him, the devil will cease to be guardian over this world. Interesting plotline for a cartoon, don't you think? Now, the Chinese law says that the princess has to marry the prince, but her heart tells her differently, so she asks Mulan for advice.
Anything wrong?
No, not at all.
Are you sure?
I just wanted to compliment you. You were so brave to take your father's place in the army.
Oh, well, thank you.
Your duty was to stay home, but your heart told you to break the rules. How did you decide between duty and heart?
Well, it wasn't easy, but by following my feelings, I wound up doing the right thing. I guess I learned that my duty is to my heart.
My duty is to my heart. Yes, that makes sense. That's marvelous.
Following and trusting in your heart is a dangerous philosophy. The Bible says in Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? The dragon tries to break up the marriage by turning Mulan against her fiancé, Shang.
Well, what do you know about that?
I mean, I know he's by the book, but doesn't the man ever bend the rule?
And speaking of bending rules...
You know, relationships are easy when everything runs nice and smooth.
Oh, but... Nice and smooth? Just ran out of camp.
Hey, what about old Shanghai?
I think I better handle this one on my own. Shang's on a short fuse as it is. Just make sure nothing wakes him up.
You can count on me.
Now the dragon wakes Shang to turn him against Mulan. Notice how he whispers suggestive thoughts in the same way that the devil whispers suggestive thoughts into our
head. She insulted you. Man, she laughed at your map.
My map.
And if she's laughing to your face, imagine what she's saying behind your back.
Back.
She's a loose cannon. She's out of control.
She's out of control.
I mean, who's in charge here?
You.
Mulan.
And also similar to the way that the devil tries to cause division amongst us, Mushu uses an illusion to deceive Shang.
General Shang. General Shang. Hello, it's me, Mulan. General Shang.
Resulting in the breaking up of their marriage. Ironically, after Mulan decides she doesn't want the marriage anymore, the dragon decides to come clean.
You're always looking out for me, Mushu.
We're just doing the best I can.
Really? I just don't know what I'd do without you. You're the best friend I've ever had.
Oh, I can't stand it no more. The only thing wrong with you is Shang. It's me. I'm the one that got between you.
What are you talking about? It's not like you made the carriage go into the river.
Now, that was an accident, following several attempts at on purpose.
And it wasn't you outside Shang's tent.
You know how I gab.
And you woke him up after I left?
It wasn't easy, neither. That man can sleep.
Mushu, what did you do?
Well, I was banging pots and pans.
No, what did you do?
You was getting married. Everything was gonna change. I was gonna lose you. And my pedestal.
You mean you got between Shang and me so you could keep your job?
I'm sorry.
The movie ends with Mulan about to be wed to a prince not of her choice. Listen to who they claim guides them in all they do.
My people, the golden dragon of unity, who guides us in all we do, today sanctifies a union that will be a blessing for all of Qigong.
This dragon of unity is that idol behind them. And just as Mulan is about to marry the prince, Shang shows up to stop the marriage.
You're alive!
I couldn't let you get married without me.
General, this is outrageous! You will leave at once!
I'm not going anywhere.
The law says that Mulan must marry the prince, but notice how they go against the law.
Where's the Dragon of Unity when you need him?
Oh, don't bother me now, Cricky.
I have an idea.
My lord, I love Mulan, and I don't care what the rules say. If she'll have me, I intend to marry her right here.
Right now.
Insolent dog sees him!
Mulan!
I am the golden dragon of unity, and I decide whom to unify. My all-seeing eye has peered into the very heart of Chang.
The little red dragon is using an idol to influence the people. Yet again, another reference to how Satan and his evil angels use idols to influence us. But the movie doesn't stop here. As the dragon packs his bags and prepares to leave his pedestal, which is inside the temple, the dead begin to harass him until Mulan and Shang walk into the temple.
Shang, what are you doing?
Watch and see.
What is he doing?
It can't be.
He's combining the family temples!
What does that mean exactly? You know, for me.
It means...
Yeah, what? What? It means what?
Unfortunately, you get to keep your pedestal.
Oh, yeah! I'm back!
This cartoon plants a seed in the children's minds. The devil will someday keep his guardianship.
What?
The theme of following your heart and not the law is very strong in the movie Aladdin.
Yes.
Keep in mind that Aladdin is a career thief, and Princess Jasmine is supposed to marry someone else. But Jasmine falls in love with this thief, following her heart and not the law. The only reason that Aladdin is rich like a prince is because of his genie friend.
I can show you the world, shining, shimmering, splendid. Tell me, princess, now when did you last let your heart decide? I can open your eyes.
Interesting. A thief saying the words, "I can open your eyes," Kind of reminds me when the devil tempted Eve in the Garden of Eden with almost the same words.
Fantastic point of view. No one to tell us no or where to go.
The idea of having a place where you can do whatever your heart desires and no one will tell you no is what brought the sin problem to our planet in the first place.
Place I never knew.
This same deception is retold in Peter Pan's movie trailer, which they played in the theater.
It's time for you to drop!
What if you could escape to a faraway world without parents?
Forget them, Wendy. Forget them all. Come away to Neverland.
Without any rules. Without anyone telling you what to do.
Come with me, we'll never, never have to worry about grown-up things again.
Never is an awfully long time.
I imagine that Lucifer deceived the angels in heaven with these exact words. Don't you want to go to a place with no rules? Ultimately resulting in Satan and his evil host being forever cast out of heaven, never to worry about rules again. Peter Pan is actually the old ancient Greek god Pan, who is worshipped as a devil. This is where we get the idea from that Satan has goat hooves and horns. This devil has made numerous appearances in children's movies such as the 1940s version of Fantasia. He was Hercules' sidekick. He made an appearance as Mr. Tumnus in the Chronicles of Narnia. He even shows up in adult cartoons such as Family Guy. This depiction of Peter Pan playing the panpipes gives his identity away. So if Pan is a devil, it starts to make sense why there is a theme of no rules and no laws. Speaking of the devil, Aladdin has this shape-shifting character called the genie, which helps him to win the princess's heart. An interesting fact about the word genie is that it comes from the Arabic word jinn, which means any of a class of spirits lower than the angels, capable of appearing in human and animal forms and influencing mankind for either good or evil. The origin of the word means demon. The dragon in Mulan, the devil in Peter Pan, and this demon in Aladdin are all portrayed as the good guys. This idea of talking to the spirits is reinforced in the movie Pocahontas. She is supposed to marry the warrior from her tribe, but her heart is telling her that she wants someone else. Once again, using one of the same storylines as some of the other films.
I need to talk to you.
Good morning, child. I was hoping you'd visit today.
Oh,
your mother's necklace.
That's what I wanted to talk to you about. My father wants me to marry Kokuum.
Kokuum? But he's so serious.
I know. My father thinks it's the right path for me. But Grandmother Willow, what is my path? How am I ever going to find it?
Your mother asked me the very same question.
She did? What did you tell her?
I told her to listen. All around you are spirits, child. They live in the earth, the water, the sky. If you listen, they will guide you.
The Bible says in plain words in 1 Timothy 4:1 that some will give heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils.
I don't understand.
Quae natura, you will understand. Listen with your heart, you will understand.
These deceiving spirits are none other than Satan and his evil angels. In Revelation 12, verse 9, it says, "And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Regard not them that have familiar spirits, neither seek after wizards to be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God." In Cinderella 2, she also goes against the rules and laws.
I'm
I've been trying to obey someone else's rules about who I should be and how I should dress.
Then she proceeds to sing this song.
Say the rules must stay the same forevermore. Open the gate. Whoever made them had to change the rules they came before. So make your own way, show the beauty within. When you follow your heart, there's no higher you can win.
The idea that rules and laws change is completely foreign to heaven's government. God's laws are never changing. They are the same today as they were yesterday. Jesus says, "Think not that I am come to destroy the law of the prophets. I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled." So we know that some of the older Disney cartoons have this rebel against the law theme. But what about this trendy new form of computer-generated cartoons? Are they continuing in this same spirit? One of the highest-grossing cartoons is Pixar's WALL-E. The movie starts out with the planet completely destroyed and vacated, with no life on it except for this tiny little robot called WALL-E. Now, when is there going to be a time when the world is completely destroyed and there is nothing on the planet except for one thing? Only after Christ's second coming and he has taken all of the saints to heaven will Satan have to sit on this earth by himself for 1,000 years to think about what he has done. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold of the dragon, that old serpent which is the devil and Satan, and bound him up for 1,000 years. And cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more, till the 1,000 years shall be fulfilled. And after that he must be loosened for a little season. So I find it interesting that they start off this movie with this dirty, lonely little robot on this deserted earth with all of the human beings that are up in the heavens on a ship sailing around waiting to return to earth after it is cleaned up so that life can start over. The humans send a robot back to Earth to see if it is safe to return. The robot is ironically named Eve or Eva. WALL-E falls in love with her. WALL-E takes Eva back to his apartment and shows her a plant that he has found. And because life is found on Earth, now the humans can return home. As the ship takes Eva back to where the humans are, WALL-E catches a ride. As WALL-E is approaching the ship, the camera pans slowly up to the name of the ship. We definitely want you to see the name. Axiom is a self-evident truth that requires no proof, a universally accepted principle or rule, or could we say, law. The law of heaven is 100% truth. The Ten Commandments are the very foundation of God's government. Order is the way of life. And WALL-E is coming into this perfect environment where everything is orderly. This paradise environment where the temperature is always perfect, it's 72 degrees and everything is always clean, is a depiction of heaven, only everyone is fat and lazy. Did you notice how everyone travels in predetermined lines? This is a gross misrepresentation of what heaven would really be like. As the rocket ship docks, There are these little robots that make sure everything is checked out to be clean before entering into this perfect environment. Notice how the workers wait until they are told they can proceed by the guiding light. As they clean each robot that has possibly come into contact with a contaminant, we see that Wally is accidentally grabbed and also checked, resulting in being 100% contaminated. The cleaner robot looks surprised as if he had never seen something so contaminated before. This is a depiction of the devil, which is 100% contaminated, and he tries to clean him to no avail. Then the police are called because Wally is not cooperating. This is where the not following the law part really comes into play. When the police come to check out what the disturbance is all about, Wally sees them take Eva in the background. He then proceeds to chase her, disregarding any rules that he must follow along the lines. He leaves a dirty trail for the cleaner robot to clean. The robot looks at the trail, which would require him to step out of the line to clean. He has never been off the line before, and he shows the fear of the consequences. But there is no consequence, so he cuts across the floor. Wally and Eva are then sent to what looks like a psychiatric ward for all of the robots that won't follow the rules or laws. You know, Satan and his rebellious followers were cast out of heaven and confined to this earth so they would not contaminate the rest of the universe. Wally then thinks that they are hurting Eva and he breaks out of his cage. Running to her rescue, he grabs her arm and accidentally fires her weapon, destroying the locks on the prison doors. All of the rogue robots are then released. They hail Wally as their savior. And they proceed to cause chaos throughout the ship. Notice how all of the police robots still follow the lines. An all-out rebellion is started on the ship. Fighting breaks out, but notice the little cleaner robot from earlier. Do you notice how he is now dirty? The chaos results in a successful revolt against the Axiom, or rules, and they chart a course to rebuild Earth. The movie closes with all of the people learning how to rebuild Earth themselves. But in the end, it isn't us that rebuild Earth, it is God. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there were no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all their tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And he that sat on the throne said, Behold, I make all things new. And he said unto me, Write, for these words are true and faithful. It isn't us that rebuild the earth, it is God. If we rebuild it, it would eventually look like this again. So looking at all these heroes that we've discussed this far, does it strike you as odd that Pan, which is the devil, is the hero, or the genie, or should I say demon, is friends with Aladdin, a thief whom the girl falls in love with, the dragon in Mulan who tries to break up the marriage of Mulan, the beauty who falls in love with the beast, this horned character who is eventually transformed into an angel of light, suggesting that there is a prince underneath the beast? Wally, who is 100% contaminated, brings chaos and rebellion into a perfect environment, and will be the savior of the planet Earth? Could all these children's stories be gaining sympathy for the devil? Simple retellings of the lies that someday Satan will be the one that saves the world and transforms it into a heaven on earth? Then a movie titled Megamind came out. There is a war in the galaxy and Megamind is forced to leave his planet, being cast down to Earth.
Turns out another family in the Glaupunk Quadrant had a very similar idea. That was the day I met Mr. Goody Two Shoes, and our glorious rivalry was born!
Mr. Goody Two Shoes is Jesus, represented as a golden baby who ironically arrives on Christmas Day to save the world. Megamind, who is Satan, rightfully arrives at a prison for the criminally gifted.
One would be cheered.
Happy Metro Man Day, Metro City.
I love you, Metro Man!
And I love you, random citizen.
While the other...
Table for two!
...was feared.
What? What?
Have you ever heard of a similar story before? Your classic story between good versus evil? But there's only one major twist. The Jesus character, yeah, the one walking on the water, decides that he doesn't want to save humanity anymore?
A new threat has come to Metro City.
Consider yourselves under new management.
And Metro Man is nowhere to be found.
He'll destroy the whole city.
I'm sorry. I'm finally free to get in touch with my true power.
Making awesome music.
You're kidding, right?
When the world needs a hero...
You need to be that guy.
Well, this is a strange turn of events.
He will answer the call.
Once again reinforcing the idea that the devil will someday step up and become the savior of the world?
I make bad
look so good. DreamWorks Megamind.
You're kidding, right?
The two songs that you just heard that were mixed together were Highway to Hell and I'm Loving You, which were so cleverly implanted into your subconscious. Disney has a long history of introducing occult philosophies to young children. But what about other cartoon companies? Are they indoctrinating kids with this same practice?
Is this some kind of a joke? A pussycat and a mouse? This show is about crazy stunts and people putting their lives at risk for a big fat prize. It's not a nature documentary. Irving, call security and have these two...
Sir, it's him.
Gives me the creeps, sir.
He's the president of Hollywood. He's supposed to give you the creeps.
Greetings, your tinsel-ness, imperious leader of Hollywood.
First of all, the pyramid with the all-seeing eye is a known occult symbol. Secondly, I find it interesting that they are claiming that the president of Hollywood is the devil. Not really a kid's theme, is it? What about SpongeBob? This show is marketed to a really young audience. So young that parents don't have the patience to sit and watch this mindless nonsense. So they place their young, impressionable-minded children in front of this babysitter, not knowing what kind of indoctrination their children are being exposed to.
I would like to call this meeting of the Good Neighbor Lodge to order. Let's begin with roll call. Patrick. By the all-seeing eye, we are worthy.
We are not.
What are you two doing?
Secret ritual.
To inaugurate you as president.
Me? President of Bikini Bottom?
No, silly. Not the president of Bikini Bottom.
You're the president of the Secret Royal Order of the Good Neighbor Lodge.
What? Oh, is this some club you two made up?
It's a secret.
This isn't the only episode that had Masonic Secret Society themes. Here is a completely different one.
I'll never forget my initiation ceremony.
Most people are completely unaware of the adult themes in cartoons, such as this SpongeBob watching pornography.
Gary! I was just looking for the sports channel, Gary.
There was an episode of The Simpsons, which was all about secret societies.
There's a secret meeting place.
Yes, let's go inside.
Sounds good.
I saw weird stuff in that place last night. Weird, strange, sick, twisted, eerie, godless, evil stuff. And I want in.
Glorifying the evil which the secret societies practice. Homer finds out his dad was a member, which makes him eligible to also be a member. Notice the paintings of the all-seeing eyes, the sun motifs, and the Masonic compasses on the wall.
I always wondered if there was a god, and now I know there is, and it's me.
The secret society members begin to worship their leader rather than God. This is the same scenario as in SpongeBob SquarePants. Once again, breaking even the first commandment of worshiping only God. The cartoon Family Guy even blasphemes our savior.
Jesus Christ at our dinner table. I still can't get over it.
I'm actually glad you're all here tonight. I want to tell you that one of you will betray me.
Just kidding.
He's doing that thing he did in his storybook.
So, Jesus, finish that story you were telling us.
Oh, all right. So there I was. They'd just beaten me senseless, stuck thorns in my head, nailed me to a piece of wood, shoved a sponge full of vinegar in my mouth, and killed me. Then, they put me in a hole with a rock in front of it for 2 whole days, and come Sunday, bam, I rise from the dead.
Okay, that sounds like a nutty weekend, but I can top it. So me and Cleveland and Joe are just wrecked on Southern Comfort, right? We know we're gonna puke, but Joe says, hey, let's go see Chronicles of Riddick. Sat through the whole thing without puking, then I get home, wouldn't you know I lost my glasses. Yeah? Peter 1, Jesus 0.
You know, Jesus, if I go get my cell phone, would you mind talking to my friend Muriel Goldman? I really just want to rub her Jewish nose in this.
All right, I'll be the one to say it. How do we know you're really Jesus? Can you perform miracles?
Sure. How about this?
Oh, boy, Sundays!
I love you, Jesus!
Oh, I love you too, fella.
Making fun of the creator of the universe who humbled himself enough to come down to our sin-sick world and make an atonement for us. doing nothing but serving a fallen humanity, healing the sick and comforting the poor. Teaching a world that has been deceived by Satan that God's laws are just and they can be kept. Demonstrating the very foundation of God's kingdom in one of the most magnificent ways shown to the universe. By loving us so much that he was willing to die our death that we deserved upon that cross. So when you see cartoons that are teaching you to follow your heart and not the law, just remember what Christ said in the Garden of Gethsemane. When everything in his body was telling him not to go through with the cross, he was begging God to take the cup from him. But he said, "Not my will, Lord, but your will be done." Had he reacted off of his heart and not his faith, we would all be lost. Did you know that there are many celebrities who won't let their children watch television? Not even a minute of it? Madonna has made millions from her inappropriate behavior on screen, yet she will not let her child watch TV.
But how do you not? How do you not? A child is pleading for something.
Because you have to, you have to have discipline. You have to teach them discipline. You have to show them who's in charge. If you give in to them every time, they're going to run your life. Come on, Larry.
Isn't it hard not to, though? Truth. Especially when you get a little old. I don't mean 38
years old. Give in when she says she wants a piece of sugarless gum, okay? Then I'll say yes. But, you know, she can't watch TV and...
She can't watch TV?
No. She won't be watching this interview.
Why can't she watch? She can't watch.
Because I don't want her to get addicted to it. Kids get addicted to it. They become mesmerized.
Barney.
No. There's no Barney in her life.
No Barney?
No.
Desperate Housewives actress Felicity Huffman and movie star husband William H. Macy stated in an article written by DisneyFamily.com that they do not let their children watch television, period. In a 2002 press release for the movie Minority Report, mega movie star Tom Cruise stated that he didn't like his children to watch television. And director Steven Spielberg stated that he only lets his children watch 1 hour per week. Helen Hunt, who banked big bucks on the hit TV show Mad About You and various other movies, told David Letterman that she does not let her child watch television, ever.
Tell me about your daughter. She's close to four, is that right? Three and a half?
Four, very soon, yeah.
Yeah. Do you have a big birthday plan for her? What do you do for the birthday?
We keep it very minimal at our house. She's never seen TV or a movie ever yet. So I don't know what she thinks I do.
So she doesn't,
she says strange people put makeup on and I leave, type a little, talk to some guy, maybe.
She's never seen you in any kind of TV.
She's never seen any TV ever.
Wow.
So we'll see, like, we'll drive by some picture of, you know, Nemo, and she'll say, oh, a fish. I'll say,
right.
It's Nemo.
Right.
What do you mean Nemo? I'll say, well, it's Nemo. It's a fish.
Mm.
Well, they named him Nemo. They named every fish.
Yeah.
No, this very special fish got to have his name.
See, now, you raise an interesting point here, because I admire the idea to protect the child from the onslaught of popular...
People like you and me.
Exactly.
I'm no dummy.
Exactly.
Interesting choice of words coming from Mr. Letterman, admitting that there is a total onslaught against the children. And how about Helen Hunt not letting her child even watch Finding Nemo? Supermodel Cindy Crawford told the press that she has banned her daughter from watching Disney's Hannah Montana because, and I quote, "it teaches her to be sassy." The French even put a ban on TV for children under three, stating that watching television can slow the development of children under three, even when it involves channels aimed specifically at them. Recent studies show why the ban is necessary.
Results from a recent Children's Hospital and UW study come with a warning. Parents of infants and toddlers, beware of how much TV your kids watch. With us this morning is Dr. Dimitri Christakis from Children's Hospital and Regional Medical Center to tell us more about this new study. Got a lot of attention when it came out because I think a lot of parents were shocked at the results. Not just some TV, but basically any TV for children under two, they were saying was bad?
Right. What we found was that the more television children watch before age three, the more likely they are to have attentional problems at age seven. And we also found recently that the more television they watch before age three, the lower their scores are on reading and letter recognition when they enter school.
Is this something that could be reversed, or is it, you know, permanent damage, so to speak, if you've already damaged their attention span?
It probably is permanent if the effects on their attention span. I think the important message for parents to learn is that you need to be very careful about how much television your very young children watch. And not just how much they watch, but what they watch and how they watch it.
The amount of influence that cartoons have on young minds is overwhelming. It's no wonder why they call Disney the Magic Kingdom. In fact, the very definition of magic is the art that by use of spells supposedly invokes supernatural powers to influence events. It is sorcery. So set your eyes onto Christ Jesus, because the kingdom of heaven is at hand.